Howdy, another week's gone by. Again, if you've watched these videos each week, you'll know by now I'm Dave Wood, and of course this is Semiosis 101. So if you want to, fast forward as usual to today's video, but if you're a newbie, you stay exactly where you are. This will be your first Semiosis 101 video. I'm Dave Wood. I'm a design educator and a researcher, a published design author, and I've worked commercially as both a freelance illustrator and graphic designer. I actually use semiotics all the time in my creative work, but probably like yourselves, I was never taught semiotic theory at design school. I'm a Scouser from Liverpool and a new Scot, and this Scout Scot Semiosis 101 YouTube channel focuses on explaining Peircean semiotic theory in a more designer-centric way to visual communication designers, illustrators, graphic designers. The guy behind the theory, Charles Sanders Peirce, wrote the theories in the late 19th, early 20th centuries in North America, and he was a philosopher, a mathematician, a theorist, but he wasn't a creative. I have a PhD in visual communication, and it took until my doctorate to actually study semiotic theory in order to really understand how to apply semiosis, the act of sign action of semiotic signs, when producing visual communication work. As a result, each week on the Scout Scot Semiosis 101 YouTube channel, I'll post at least one 10-minute explainer video on an aspect of Peirce's pragmatic semiotic theory. Each free Semiosis 101 10-minute video will use design-centric terms instead of theoretical language so that illustrators and graphic designers can follow and understand. Each video will feature a take-home piece of applicable semiotic theory, and they do interconnect to build up your understanding of semiosis. This channel, it's not a course in semiotics per se. Instead, each video is a bite-sized illustrated piece of new knowledge on sign action, or semiosis, as Peirce names it. The aim of these three videos is to take Peirce's quite complex philosophical theoretical language and put it in the context of designing visual communication, whether these are illustrations, motion, branding, packaging, editorial, etc. So whether you are just interested in semiotics, or you are a semiotician, a visual communicator, an illustrator, a graphic designer, interested in knowing how Peirce's semiosis theory can help to enhance your visual communication skills, then please like these videos, subscribe to this channel below, and if you want to know when next week's video is ready on YouTube, hit the bell button. Let's get to today's sixth episode on general Peircean semiotic theory for illustrators and designers. Today, in around 10 minutes, we will focus on how semiosis aligns itself with another theory that benefits visual communication, Gestalt theory. I'll first outline Gestalt theory in just basic terms, as there are other YouTubers such as Tiptoot who can give you all a fuller Gestalt theory explanation. Then I'll outline how Gestalt theory and semiosis can be a powerful team of underpinning theories to enhance the effectiveness of your visual communication. By bringing in Gestalt theory to this discussion of Peirce's pragmatic semiotic theory, we open up the conversation to the first powerful set of three levels of sign action: iconic, indexical, and symbolic. It will be a double theory pack 10 minutes of semiotic theory, but in design-centric terms. So stay tuned, subscribe, and let's head into theory land. Today we're going to focus on, obviously, semiotic theory, semiosis. But to get to where I want to get to discuss iconic level of semiotic representation from a Peircean point of view, we will get there via another theory. We're still part of theory land here, and we'll move towards Peircean theory through, essentially, Gestalt theory. Now, Gestalt is a psychology term, and we use that in visual communication a lot because it helps designers, illustrators, creatives understand the fundamentals of the building blocks of visual communication. In Gestalt, the whole image is different from the sum of its parts. So think about the parts that make up any image or any design. It's made up of multiple parts, whether or not those are lines, circles, shapes, colors, textures, all of these things all make up the visuals that we use to communicate the concept to our intended audience. And what I'm going to be arguing throughout this talk is the fact that those parts are essentially iconic parts, using a Peirce semiotic term. Okay, so there are parallels between Gestalt theory and the fundamental starting point of semiosis, the iconic level of semiotic representation. All right. So let's just, before we move forward, let's just get a little bit of an underpinning of Gestalt theory. Now, there are other videos on YouTube itself that will go into Gestalt theory in a lot more depth than what I'm going to go through. So I'm going to give just an overview of it, but I'm going to shape it through three things that I think is important for us as visual communication designers, graphic designers, illustrators, to accept. So Gestalt theory itself is based upon the idea that we as humans tend to organize visual elements into groupings. Now, these groupings form unified wholes based on several factors, and those three factors I want to focus on here. There's many more, but I'm just going to focus on three here. First one, objects will be perceived in the simplest iconic form. And I'm definitely using the word iconic there in a Peircean context. And over the coming weeks, we'll explore exactly what we mean when we talk about semiosis and iconic. Okay, there'll be a video coming up in several weeks' time, just purely on iconicity. The second point is humans naturally follow lines or curves to understand what they're looking at. And the third point is that human mind will attempt to fill in detail that isn't there. Now, those three things, objects will be perceived in their simplest forms, humans naturally follow lines or curves to understand what they're looking at, and the human mind will attempt to fill in any detail that isn't there. They're three underpinning elements that Gestalt theory is built upon. I'll leave that to Gestalt theorists to explain better in their videos. But from here, this is where I want to move forward. To do that, I'm going to focus on six of the many elements of Gestalt theory that are really relevant to visual communication designers and illustrators. Okay, so let's move on to the first one. The figure and the ground. So these are not in any particular order, but we'll start off with the figure and the ground. If you think about the figure as the elements and the ground as the background, what it's contained on. So here we see a circle. In our context, it's a figure. And the background, which is the bubble background of Semiosis 101. The figure itself is white, and that pops that circle out from the multicolored background. If it was reversed and the background was white and the circle itself was multicolored, again, it would pop out from the background. So we've got contrast between the figure and the ground. And both of those can swap around depending on the need from a visual communication point of view of what is important within a hierarchy of elements. Is it important that the figure pops from the background, or the background gives the impression that there's something there, a figure in that background? Okay, so let's move on from where we are with figure and ground to closure. So all I've just done here is colored that circle red. And you've probably already noticed that I refer to it as a circle, but it's not a circle. It's a circle with a gap. But because I've already mentioned the word circle to you, then essentially you've been doing the second Gestalt yourself. You've been making a closure of that circle, that you see a circle rather than a circle with a gap. So that's closure, the fact that the eye can jump that gap to make it feel like it is a circle, even though we know it's not a full circle. it is essentially a curved line that doesn't meet in a circular way. So let's introduce another element here, and we've got continuation. We can see now that our red circle, and I'll keep calling it red circle because we've already covered closure, we can now see that it's almost forming a figure of eight. So we've got the fact that we've got continuation. So we can see that the curves of the lines, even though one's colored green and the other one's colored red, there's a continuation that helps with our perception that this could be a figure of eight shape, but they are actually two shapes next to each other, very close to each other. The proximity are coming together, more about that in a minute. And we've got closure there because there are gaps, but our eye could perceive that as a figure of eight, even though it's not a figure of eight. It's not a number, it's just two shapes. So let's move forwards to symmetry. Okay, symmetry within visual communication design, where two elements or many elements mirror each other and form a pleasant, balanced point of view. In this case, we've got two circles balancing each other out on a diagonal. We've got two different colors so that one stands out from the other. So it's not perceived exactly as a figure of eight, but it's perceived as two interlinked hoops, maybe. Already we're starting to interpret what these things could be. And symmetry is helping us read what is essentially just two, I'm going to use the word, iconic rough shapes. Okay? But those shapes have a similarity to each other. And when shapes have got a similarity, then we can read things into this. And as you can see, that by introducing a few more like circular shapes that work on continuity, works on the fact that you've got the fact that the closure isn't there, but we can still see the circles, then all of a sudden you got the sense of something is emerging here that we have a way of reading as an audience. We can see and perceive that this is not just random shapes. So, you know, I think you know where this is leading to. So let's go to the final one we're going to discuss within Gestalt Theory, which is proximity. Now, by introducing proximity of these shapes that are interlinking together forms this bigger shape, and this bigger shape in our culture has a meaning, and I'll leave that to you to decipher what that meaning could possibly be. There's a gold medal for anybody who gets it correctly. So we have here proximity of all these shapes and colors next to each other in such a way that it gives meaning. So I've been talking about this so far purely in Gestalt Theory. But Gestalt Theory is just another way of approaching semiosis. And that's where we're going to jump to right now. Because all of these shapes you got here in proximity are essentially iconic. Because that's all they are. They're just resemblances to circles and curves. And that when you put them together in a particular way, they have a familiarity to a circle or to a hoop or to a ring. And if you put them in a particular color coordinated pattern, they represent a big sporting event every 4 years. Let's just put it that way. But essentially, all they are just lines and colors and shapes. And from a Peircean point of view, that is the fundamental starting point of semiosis. The iconic representation of the concept to be communicated. Now remember, Peirce says, nothing is a sign unless it is interpreted as a sign. So these shapes themselves, different colors, different colors. If you just go by the colors, you know, there's some of the colors there. You can make all kinds of different country representations from that, because a lot of countries' flags have these colors in them. So, you know, even though the circles, you can put them into color combinations to create different countries' motifs for representing the country. So these are just basic building blocks of just colored lines and shapes that we begin to attribute meaning to them when all of a sudden we begin to interpret them as a sign for something else. Intrinsically, they are just what they are, just shapes of colors. It's not until we as human beings start applying meaning, potential meaning or interpretation to the combinations of these shapes, that as soon as that begins to happen, semiosis is beginning. So just to end today's actual talk on Gestalt Theory and Semiosis, you can see the fact that where we have really quite complex visual language that represents big events and small events, big things and small things that have value and meaning in our everyday lives, that are visual, they have been designed from the iconic level up. And that iconic level is the very kickstarter, from graphic design and illustration point of view, of somebody actually beginning to seek the meaning in your work. So if you can nail the iconic level, and that is essentially started in your sketchbooks, as soon as you put a line, a drawing in your sketchbook, a little sketch, you're starting to work iconically without even thinking about it. Because it means something to you, you're putting marks down that will hopefully mean something to somebody else. And that something is hopefully what you want them to take from your imagery, your visual communication. So it all builds up from very basic things that resemble things that we already know. And in that resemblance, that iconicness, we, as visual communication designers and illustrators, we have power to craft meaning with just a few colors, lines, textures. And by using Gestalt Theory, that helps us put those colors and lines and shapes, etc., into some forms of patterns that can be semiotically interpreted by our target audience. So that's today's talk over. Come back next week and we'll have another talk where we'll move this forward. So I'm going to leave you on a sort of cliffhanger with what do we mean by iconic, and put a pin in that, come back to us next week, and we will explore what we mean when we talk in semiosis terms, what iconic actually is. See you next week. So that is our 10 minutes of Peircean Semiosis 101 for this week. You can now see how Peirce's semiosis theory of semiotics can work with Gestalt Theory to enhance visual communication in illustration and graphic design. Check out the link in the description and visit TipTut's YouTube channel and video on Gestalt principles for basics for beginners. This brief theoretical sidestep from Peirce into Gestalt has opened the conversation on applying semiosis more effectively into visual communication design to begin to discuss the three levels of representation of the concept. Peirce uses three terms to describe these three levels of sign action in semiotic representation of a concept: the icon, the index, and the symbol. These words will have existing denotative meaning for you already, probably. But from now onwards, we will begin to go deeper into the philosophical structuring of the semiotic sign action. And this will mean careful explanation of how Peirce uses his terms and the insights that then gives you to understand semiosis. Over the coming videos in Semiosis 101, you will get to understand in more design-centric terms the mechanics of semiosis and how these can be applied within the ideation and design phases of illustrating or coming up with the design outcomes as part of your design process. I hope as creatives you agree that Peirce's semiotic theory of semiosis offers a lot of rich pickings to enhance our visual communication skills. There will be another video next week, so come back again. By following this Scout Scott YouTube channel, you will learn how Peirce's pragmatic semiotic theory of semiosis can help to enhance and improve how you visually communicate. I have many more Peircean semiotic topics to discuss, but I would be interested in hearing about your semiotic ideas. Add a comment below. If you like this video, check out my other semiotic videos and consider liking and sharing the videos with others. The more we creatives discuss semiotic theory, the easier its application into our creative processes will be. Over the years, I have collaborated with other design academic researchers and Peircean semioticians to develop a designer-centric explanation of Peirce's theoretical language. If you are interested in reading my Semiotic Rosetta Stone academic writing, then you can visit my academia.edu link in the description. As a fellow creative and a published design author, I also have links in the description to my Scout Scott Redbubble shop featuring illustrated and typographical gift ranges, and to my 2014 design book published by Bloomsbury Publishing, Interface Design, An Introduction to Visual Communication in UI Design. Any other books on Peircean semiotics I've mentioned in the videos are also listed in the description. Check them out too. Thanks for watching. Check out the other videos, like and share them with your friends, and hit the bell button to be notified when next week's video is published on YouTube. See you all again next week for more Semiosis 101 to help illustrators and designers to enhance your visual communication skills.